trouble. Gabby shot down. It's Nisha with the triple kill.
One strike use Echo Slam catches out three. Oh, hold for a kill. Give it the Rampage to pass. Back up as well. That's crit. He gets delayed up there. Cool.
For us, it's kind of like our life. It's like everything we really kind of aim for. Everything is on the line. It's not about the money or anything. It's just like the fact, like, whoever wins that, it goes down in the history books for Dota.
The International, with a $40 million prize pool, it is the single biggest esports event in the world.
You win the first prize, you're in Southeast Asia, you retire for the rest of your life.
There's so much pressure because you've worked so hard for this whole year or years to get here. This is your chance. It can make you play better or it can break you.
We know the COVID is getting serious. That impacted us a lot. Right now, it's been a year, so I'm really happy that we had a Singapore major.
If there's a dark horse in the Singapore major, it will be us.
By qualifying for a major and by placing high, I believe the top 12 points in the world get invited to the International.
This year, the goal is to win the Singapore major.
We just want to be better every game, and we just want to stay as a team.
Me and esports, we never qualified to the International. But we think this year is the year.
Esports, a billion-dollar industry. Once a niche hobby, now a global mega beast.
Triple kill, can he get the Rampage?
Competitive gaming has turned passionate recreational gamers into global superstars.
Esports is a young industry. The fan bases are getting larger, and they're being more vocal, more passionate, more enthusiastic.
Esports fans across the world can join together, come together at a tournament and cheer and celebrate the game together, and that goes for all the esports.
I've always dreamed of a world where this would be like Anno, the sport of the future, the new reality.
Won't get control, the Dream Call, it's a backline, so much damage, Viper as well as Prophet just evaporate.
But no game has captivated gamers and obsessed fans like Dota 2.
Dota 2 is a game that you're never done with. You'll always be drawn back to it because that is the game that gives me mentally the biggest challenge and also the biggest satisfaction. If I explain Dota 2 to anyone that doesn't know Dota 2, you can consider it a three-dimensional chess game, or I can see it as an onion on the outside with loads of layers and all that. Dota has, like, once you figure out the layer that you see, you peel it off, there's another one.
The game pits two teams of five against each other. They have to destroy their opponent's base and towers while defending their own ones too.
You also need to spend time not just blindly playing, but actually focusing on testing out new things, understanding the game, how it works, and also doing calculations. A lot more than just picking up your mouse and keyboard and playing the game. To get to that level, I think you need a great deal of sacrifice.
Professional gaming has become a viable career and is catapulting players into the global spotlight.
These pro players, they are like, I know, rock stars.
Federer, Messi, Ronaldo, LeBron. Our athletes belong on those same pedestal.
A lot of these players started playing when they're very young. That they start playing pubs with their brothers sometime, and someone picked them up from a ranking, from a list somewhere. It's crazy. A lot of these players have a lot of unique stories.
They have a huge number of people following them. What they do, what they say, what they drink, what they eat is very important for the fans. And a lot of them have a lot of national pride. So when they see a player from their own country playing, wow, they are cheering and doing whatever it takes to support that player.
cores are melting. LFY are not farming. They're fighting and they're losing the fights. Meanwhile, LFY also streaming in with the Echo and a
Dota 2 has arguably been a massive influence to how competitive esports has evolved.
Konami are the champions!
It became the first game to bring an esports tournament to the grand stage, putting it in the same league as the biggest sporting events in history.
No Tail, what comes next, buddy? It's been a very long journey for you. You have gone so far, you've been in Dota for so long. What's the next goal, man?
The goal has always been TI.
The International, also known as TI, is the ultimate tournament for any pro Dota player.
For the Dota 2 fans, the International is like, it's the Super Bowl of Dota 2. If you want to be the best in the world, you gotta win the International.
The International is basically the biggest esports tournament by far, actually, out of all the games. It is, I believe, the largest event in esports, and it has been for many years now.
The pride on this team, the composure on the big stage, they take down the defending champions.
If you only win internationals, doesn't matter if you do poop the whole year round, you're gonna be considered a world champion. That's how it works. That world title, that prestige, that's what it's all about.
It's very life-changing. The prize money of it is, you win the first prize, you're in Southeast Asia, you retire for the rest of your life. That's how big it is.
Isn't it about it? Oh my God!
Getting to the International, you need to basically accumulate points over the year, and then the top 16 teams who get the most amount of points, they get to go to TI.
Welcome to the International.
Is it all about shit?
In tennis, there are a few big tournaments, right? And in Dota 2, this year there are two majors. And if you do well in these majors, that helps you qualify for the International. And currently, the prize pool for the International is over $40 million.
Odor wants fly, protect himself inside the super.
Legacy teams like Evil Geniuses and Fnatic have been through the International multiple times. The players know what's at stake.
Playing a TI is having that pressure twice as much or even more than any other event because it just feels like there's so much hanging on this.
Go down, GG, Fnatic continue their...
I've been to 3 TI now. The atmosphere in a TI event is more like a serious one because that's the biggest tournament Dota has to offer and every team wants to play really well and they're really serious about it.
For Dota players, this is what we aim for. This is what we want to win. We want to win, obviously, the biggest tournament of them all.
One team that has never been to TI is OB Neon. The Philippines-based Dota 2 team has only been in the scene for 4 years and have been relatively under the radar.
How many times has Neon qualified for TI?
5,000, no, zero.
Here.
Zero times. But if we win, it will be a great honor for us, of course, to represent the Philippines because, you know, Filipinos, they cling to this, you know, Filipino pride. And being able to hoist the Aegis or the trophy beside the Filipino flag, it'll be a great honor.
This year, TI is going to be very different. In 2020, the 10th installment of TI was meant to take place in Stockholm. But as the world battled against COVID-19, everything, including plans for TI 10, was put to a halt.
In 2020, for Dota 2, it had a really big impact because, you know, they canceled the major, they canceled the International, and because of that, most of the teams, they closed shop.
As a result of the pandemic, the community would have wanted more tournaments because you're gonna sit at home more. A lot of people have been sitting at home more and there weren't any more tournaments. Since the moment that LAN events were canceled, I'm like, okay, bring them back, please.
Since the pandemic and TI being canceled, we had a lot of time off. So we didn't get to experience what it's been like as a team together physically. We did get to play a lot online, like we had 6 weeks. But it's not the same.
For Obi Neon, training in a pandemic means having to make some drastic decisions. The boys have set up a closed camp in an apartment in the Philippines.
Nagigising kami as a team around 11 or 12.
Food's here. Share lang tayo dito.
Tapos kakain ligo. Tapos kailangan mag-one game muna kami bago practice namin. Ang routine namin ay parehas lang before or after pandemic. Yung nakakaiba lang siguro, hindi kami makapaglabas kung magtitimbanding kami.
Here in the camp, it's like a bubble where we really don't want to leave. We don't want to expose ourselves and we don't want to risk our players' health. The biggest sacrifice, I think, is not being able to see your families because of the global pandemic. We just had to, you know, stay inside, train, and make the most of it, really.
Fortunately for the players, the sacrifice may just as well pay off. That's because the next Dota League is making a comeback.
He wants Anisha up instead of the follow-up, jumps in. Ramsey, he gets all four of them.
He doesn't bring anyone down. The static storm goes down and spinning a lot. Tommy Kaiser.
They got Gabby. He's going to die as well. Oh my god, the turnaround.
Dota 2 is making a comeback with the 2021 Dota Pro Circuit, or the DPC. This after months of suspension due to the COVID-19 pandemic.
To have the DPC restarted, I mean, that I needed that. The DPC is the start that things are looking up again, right? That we will find a way to continue on.
Before COVID-19, we would have a lot of live events. But again, as I said, the beauty of esports, it was born online, born virtually, and we'll just do it where we started from, which was online and virtually. What I hope is that the world continues to recognize esports as the future of sports and entertainment. And I think what has happened in 2020 certainly has raised the attention of a lot of people around esports and the promise of esports.
Well, firstly, congratulations. Huge win today versus TNC. How does it feel to be going to the major?
Of course, I'm very happy. And this is our first major. So yeah, I'm excited to play.
It is the first DPC season of the year and the first step to qualifying for a place at the international.
Teams play in their regions. There's 8 teams in an upper division in a league. If you are playing in the upper division, you have a chance to qualify for a major.
And this major is very important because think about it. If you do well in this major, you don't necessarily need to do well in the second major. So people want to qualify for the international now so they can relax.
45 seconds, there's no sense of defense here for T1. It's looking like Neon are gonna get it done, and there's no way to stop this. Neon, they'll go after the throne, and they will take the game, take the series, and move on into second place.
Dota 2 rookies Obi Neon had surprised esports fans by coming in second in Southeast Asia to qualify for the next major. Their rivals, the legendary Team Fnatic, came in first.
When we first found out that the team qualified for the major, we were happy, of course. The boys were shouting, they were jumping around, you know, because it makes us one step closer to our goal, which is TI, the international.
The first major of the DPC is set to take place here, Singapore. It will be the first offline event to take place since the start of the pandemic.
The Singapore major is important for Dota 2 for a few reasons. The first is that Dota 2 has, from a competition perspective, has kind of been inactive for more than 12 months. So the fans are dying to get back onto esports and see these teams compete. A lot of competitions have happened at the regional level. They haven't happened at the international level.
This is the first major, the first LAN event that we've had in over a year. And for me, the Singapore major is a chance to watch those inter-regional matchups again, and I'm super excited about that.
The Singapore Major is a partnership between PGL and ONE Esports.
ONE's role is to host the Singapore Major, and more importantly, is tell the story of all the teams and the rivalry and the competition and what makes this thing so exciting for the rest of the world. We don't just do events. The secret is you got to bring to bear all of the different parts of media, all different parts of that fan experience, and it needs to coalesce maybe in an event.
For content, after each date of the Singapore Major, we'll have a complete article wrap-up of all the matches.
Singapore is the right place for a major for several reasons. I come from New York City, and I tell people Singapore is like kind of living in Star Trek. I mean, it's such an advanced country.
Currently, this is the preliminary stage design.
This is no ordinary tournament. In light of the pandemic, a competition of this scale and importance will have to take on a different look.
So first of all, running large-scale esports events within COVID-19 is not easy. And you need to have an amazing set of partners to deliver an event. And in our case, you know, we had PGL and we had STB, Singapore Tourism Board, and they were relentless in their support of us and incredibly creative and innovative in helping us deliver this world-class event. Esports is gonna go whether there is a pandemic, whether there is a hurricane or a typhoon or a tsunami or an earthquake, esports will continue. And that is the beauty of our sport and of our fans.
With the backing of the city-state, the Dota 2 Major is all set to take place. And this is where it will be held, the Fairmont Hotel, Singapore. The ballroom floor is getting dressed for the closed international event.
Singapore Tourism Board are coming in this afternoon, so they're really the ones that have set the safe management protocol for the whole event. They're coming in to check where we are at and make sure that we are ready.
Like many hotels, they have had to adapt to the pandemic, and the Singapore Major is a huge boost for them. However, the five-star experience isn't the same anymore.
So here we've got the, through the fence there, if you can see, is the check-in for guests coming in for stay-home notice.
All players and event staff will have to come through this special check-in desk and will enter what is known as the bubble. Once they enter, there's no leaving until the event is over. In the meantime, it is a mad rush to partition the fourth floor. As part of COVID-19 measures, this is to prevent the public from interacting with the international attendees.
You make it nice and neat, but the problem is that then people can just lift the whole thing up and come underneath. I just don't think they're gonna accept that.
Okay, good.
All right, mate, thank you. There's some things we need to do after the initial stage. We've got to make some changes, but we don't have to do that till the event really kicks off.
It's days away from the tournament, and teams all across the world have started making their way to Singapore. But it hasn't been smooth sailing for all the teams.
My name is Wilson Tang. I'm the Dota 2 administrator for the Evil Geniuses. I handle everything from flights, hotel scheduling, visas, and also entry requirements. For example, for this major, I had a lot of entry requirements.
I have a checklist of it, and all my players are from different countries, so like they have all the different documents they need to get and all the different regulations as well. One of the busiest time of my life.
Arguably, no team is facing a greater roadblock than OB Neon. With COVID-19 cases rising in the Philippines, there's a chance the players can't fly out.
A few days before the Singapore Major, the Philippines, they imposed this travel restriction. It made us felt bad and worried because, you know, everything we worked for, suddenly it felt like we had no chance to compete in Singapore.
OB Neon has to apply for exemptions to be allowed to return. They need to work closely with their rivals, Fnatic and Evil Geniuses, who also have Filipino players.
Obviously, Philippines introducing their new travel ban did not make things easy for us because it came very last minute, and we had to figure out whether the Filipinos can come home after the event.
While the teams try to sort their flights, back in Singapore, the nuts and bolts of the event are taking shape. A lot of set building is required for an esports event like this, even for one without a live audience. Local event crew, the show company, is starting off the early infrastructure works.
Today is the first day of our setup. Basically, what we're trying to achieve today is to set up basically the lighting structure for the green screen, as well as to set up the green room for the caster and analyst talents that PGL are bringing down.
While the show company is setting up, the bulk of the event build is overseen by internationally acclaimed esports organizers, PGL.
Well, PGL is a project that I started somewhere in the summer of 2000. So initially we started to run national championships for various games like Counter-Strike, Quake, Warcraft, what was good back then. And slowly from 2016 until the present, we have started to work with pretty much all the game publishers on the planet. Mostly Valve, Electronic Arts, Bethesda, Microsoft, Supercell, everybody.
Although some trusses and structures have been built, part of the works today have come to a standstill. This is because the main showrunners, PGL, have yet to arrive in Singapore.
So now, because of the delay in the cargo, we had to rearrange everybody's schedules. Quickly arrange transport and all the manpower and everything to in order to get it done by today.
While the event slowly takes shape in Singapore, the Filipino players get the all clear to fly.
Thank you for the opportunity you've given us to compete in Singapore.
However, for Obi Mion, they are struck with another round of bad news. Their teammate Natsumi cannot take part in the major.
Because of Natsumi not being able to come here, we had to find, a replacement. And the best one, the suitable one for us was, Rappi, who played with us already.
Yeah, we're on our way to the boarding gate right now. See you in Singapore, guys.
The team finally gets to take off for Singapore, albeit with an unexpected roster change.
The teams were more likely to be excited than anxious because the personality of the boys, they just want to play, they're just, game on always.
The team from PGL have just arrived at the hotel ahead of the games. It's a sign that the start of the tournament is imminent. They have to check into the hotel separated from regular guests and will have to be quarantined in their rooms until they are cleared of COVID-19, which means that the setup now solely depends on the show company.
The biggest challenge of this event at the moment would be the communication and contact with PGL beforehand for this event. When PGL moves in, that's when the integration actually starts and that's when we'll have more work to do.
The Singapore Major is the first Dota 2 LAN event since the start of the pandemic. The showrunners, PGL, have been released from quarantine and have been buckling down to complete the setup. And it's just in time for the arrival of the players and talents. All attendees are to be quarantined in their hotel rooms until they are officially cleared of COVID-19. While in quarantine, casters Shiva and OD Pixel get a little surprise from Tammy.
Hey guys!
Hi Tammy!
Former Dota 2 manager Tammy is filming a local food tour outside of the competition bubble. She's picking out some treats for her friends in quarantine.
In front of me now, I have biryani and chicken rice, two of Singapore's iconic dishes. OD and Shiva, I know you can't be right here with me now, but I'm sending you some in a little bit.
That got here super fast, and you are absolutely right. This smells amazing. You can't eat all of this because...
Oh, no. Okay. I'm going back for some biryani. Grab some more of this. This is not lasting much longer here in this room, I'll tell you that.
I mean, this
it's
is...
It's a good biryani.
That's a winner. Mm.
Once the talents and players have passed their COVID-19 tests, they are then allowed to participate in the tournament. But players can only do so in dedicated trading suites.
Albert, can we have a talk about this electricity?
If it's what we have done is that we have run a different supply for each individual rooms that they're going to set it up.
Yeah.
Okay. So from the riser itself, we provided about 10 kilowatt of supply.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
So an entire floor of the Fairmont has been blocked off and refurbished to facilitate training for the players.
The 10th floor is essentially, this is the practice suites. So this is where all the teams will be coming. So we've set aside 14 suites, which will be turned into suites with six PCs. The whole thing set up is where they actually do the sort of all their training. And now I just need to check now because we've got all these secret lab chairs going in the rooms. So we need to make sure, because some of them have got, they're for individual teams. We need to make sure we put in the right chair in the right room.
With the practice rooms all set up and ready for the event, the players now have a place where they can not only train,
I ordered chicken rice,
but bond as a team.
Yeah, I want.
But it's not all fun and games. These 45 square meter rooms is where the tournament begins.
Good morning and welcome to the ONE Esports Dota 2 Singapore Major. It's been over a year since we were live with the last international LAN.
BKB, Requiem Soul, and Shadow Race.
Snowball save.
Not going to be insufficient damage. However, the support getting pulled back by the
Aerosmith.
Blood hit on two. No way.
Already, Moxie starting off the ice. Jumping in after life. He's going to go with the Black Hole. He's only caught in Sadia for now. Then a Cataclysm.
And he died.
Turned through him.
That's it.
The Refresher Cataclysm. It's all too much.
The tournament begins with the wildcard teams competing for their training suites. They don't get to see their opponents while their plays are broadcasted from these rooms.
The Singapore Major is divided in three parts. There's the wild cards, there's the group stage, and there's the playoffs. So the three teams that win the wild cards will move to the group stage. Out of that group stage, seven teams will move forward to the playoffs. There are already six teams in the playoffs.
Evil Geniuses and Fnatic were top of their regional leagues, so they qualify for the playoffs, a straight path to victory. OBI Neon, however, came in second in the Southeast Asian League, so they first have to fight in the next phase of the tournament, the group stage.
Our main goal is to win the major, but yeah, top five, I think it's the best one. If we reach that, it would mean everything to us, but if our team gets eliminated in the group stage, that would be a very devastating result for us, of course.
But before group stages can even begin, the tournament faces another curveball.
So the initial format was built for 18 teams. Unfortunately, two of the teams weren't able to fly anymore due to health reasons, and we've altered the format. We are going to qualify one more team from the group stage to the playoffs, which also the teams are very happy with it as well.
We were really aiming for the upper bracket, and opening one more slot, it increases our chances. So we're, you know, it boosts our confidence definitely.
Welcome back everyone to the ONE Esports Singapore Major presented by PGL. Let's take a look at the teams that we have in the group stage.
And now we have all six regions being represented. This is where it's going to be, you know, we've been hyping up the fact it's been over a year since we've had that cross-region play.
Coming up next, Quincy Crew versus Neon Esports.
Look at the bans, just the heroes that we see so frequently. We won't see Aya, we won't see Puck, we won't see Enigma. Maybe they
The tournament finally begins for the boys of OBI Neon. They have four matchups today, and there's anxiety about their roster changes.
I think for the Southeast Asian region in general in Dota 2, it has a big question mark on it for me. There's been shuffles, quite a few shuffles in terms of who's playing on which team, and I kind of feel that the dust has not been settled yet.
Do you have any suggestion as of lane?
We moved Scam to the carry role because he was off the off lane. We changed the roles a bit. Hopefully, we can still perform at our highest.
they have a stand-in who's going to be playing position 4, and then Playhard will be on the offlane. So we'll see. That's a lot of changes in one team in such a short period.
And Neon, the last 2-3 fights, they really just used their abilities massively. They have no buybacks, this game is just over. GG.
The games are not looking good for OB Neon.
Is there a way they're able to turn this around here? Void's a bit falling low, but a nice short step that gives them the space, and now with the movement in, Silence drop leave and just call it quits. Before the rest of the heroes die, they know they can offer up no defense after that, as Vici Gaming will clean this series up in 2-0 fashion.
Pretty convincing and pretty disappointing, to be, if I'm being perfectly honest.
You know, we've seen Neon today, it didn't look that great.
No, we could take a look at the standings if I'm mentioning that, because OB Neon, you can see all the way at the bottom, they have not had a good time.
What is going on here? Now buyback.
You're on a buyback.
Trying so hard to stop that, but you can't stop the Batrider.
Oh my right, goodness,
GG, what a weird way to end Neon. The game.
Rough having a stand-in, but it's... You know, in the end, that's what it's come out to here for Neon. But they need a complete 360 here if they're going to want to show at least some fight against LGD.
I don't know if it's necessarily communication. I think it's more just Natsumi has a far more aggressive playstyle that he had to learn to be part of his Neon team. It had a really good time in the upper division.
The exorcism ghosts. Dealing with the tier 4 tower. They're going to try and commit heavily here. Nice counter on the backline as well. They're going to try and deal with the support.
So
meanwhile,
tanky.
But it will not matter. Faith Beyond is too tanky for this. The initial jump is all for naught here as they're both stuck inside the surf once. Meanwhile, Ame able to deal with the backline here. Shaman drop. ET is able to buy it back, but they're just going to call it. There's absolutely nothing Neon can do. And PSG LGD. We'll take this series here 2-0 in incredibly convincing fashion.
It's a little bit too crazy, and I feel like Neon hasn't really figured out who goes where and what. Throughout the entire day, they've been shifting about a little bit.
OB Neon has lost almost all of their series today, and they are in danger of elimination. They still have one more day to turn things around.
That is now day one done of the groups. Tomorrow we're going to have 4 series and 4 important series as well. Keep in mind, 3 teams move to the upper bracket, 4 teams move to the lower bracket, only 1 team is eliminated.
OB Neon's losses is not going to be the worst thing to happen today. As the games come to a close, the boys are about to receive some very bad news. The first day of group stages have come to a close. OB Neon is at the bottom of the league and are in danger of elimination.
In the first day of our group stages, we started really slow. We lost most of our matches. But every game we started strong, but we couldn't really finish the game, so we ended up losing most of the games.
However, before the boys can compete in their second day of groups, things took a turn for the worse.
OB Neon, they've been struggling in groups. Now they've kind of put Rappy away because, well, there's a sticky situation with him and contact tracing.
On the flight to Singapore, Rappy had been in contact with a COVID-19 carrier. He has to be isolated and effectively removed from the competition.
Well, it was around 10 p.m., already nighttime. I was ready to go to bed, so... Yeah, and then suddenly PGL, they messaged me that, you know, Rappy, he was in close contact when he arrived in Singapore. PGL asked us if we have a stand-in ready, and at the time I just had a massive headache because we didn't have anyone ready.
So I'm Dev from Singapore, and I'm also a pro Dota 2 player, and I'm standing in for Neon Esports. So last night, actually I was asleep and it was like 11:30, and one of the players from Neon, Scam, he was like, trying desperately to look for a stand-in, and Scam called me until I woke up, and yeah. I mean, I'm a bit nervous, and I just don't want to let the team down, you know, like, because they asked me to stand in, and you know, I just want to make sure that I play the best I can and help them, you know, get to the playoffs.
Yes, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back. We are here for the second day of the group stages for the Singapore Major.
Do you guys play Enigma?
We don't play, but
If you like, we can play it too.
OB Neon will be facing off with three teams today: Thunder Predator, Alliance, and Team Liquid.
Daedalus now and Yapash, my goodness, they roll in Janual, perfect onto the Raid King. MJZ already dead on the Oracle, now the Jewel out, Death just holding him down. He'll go down without buyback, that's gotta be it. Frank rolled on, they call it, they've had enough. And you know what, John, this is what I was saying before the tournament started. Neon were one of my favorites before those roster issues happened.
I can safely say, Neon lang malakas, there you go boys. PH Pride.
Response shot. Short with the hook.
Playhard right in, Death to follow up, Vacuum into the T4 towers, but they just poke them up.
I think Neon's going to be very hungry for the win. They've got something to prove.
It's going
to
be painful in Alliance. They're coming out of the base. This is not what they want. Skem, he's going to see them. Oh, Death, he's got the stun off. They just control the backside. Hanskin's gone. FNG, he's gone. Limp S4. That'll be game one in the books between Neon and Alliance. 32k net worth lead at the end.
With two out of three series down, OB Neon is now tied for last place with Alliance.
Both teams are on the edge of leaving groups, so this is like, let's be frank, this is the bottom two teams right now facing off against each other. So if one of them finds a 2-0, they're suddenly not the bottom team, and they're suddenly not in the running to be eliminated.
OB Neon has to win the next series if they want to make it to the playoffs. Unfortunately, that series is against European powerhouse, Team Liquid. Team Liquid is one of the strongest Dota 2 teams in the world. The odds are stacked against OB Neon.
Yeah, we're looking forward to playing them, even though we think that they're the strongest team.
It's gonna be OB Neon taking on Team Liquid here. Danog, we saw Neon, they've kind of come maybe into the shell a little bit here. They are playing with Death instead of Rafi. Xenia with the Exism, but it's just not enough damage right now. Team Liquid, they have to retreat away. They've gone too deep. Where's the actual lockdown coming through for the Rolling Thunder? Potentially they haven't used it just yet, but it doesn't matter to Beal. He's shredding them apart. Boxy has to drop the ultimate, and Xenia is still going to get shredded apart. The Beal does so much damage. Triple kill, Beal, Gorlak, and they call it. Neon, they're going to take game one here against Liquid.
Say it time and time again, don't sleep on C because they'll come back and bite you. Neon are in scintillating form against some of these high quality teams.
And Death, I feel, is an upgrade. So for me, that's a great positive. Death coming in, he was actually performing really, really well. Is that enough to throw Neon off of this funk they're in? I'm not entirely sure.
I prefer not to play like Van Odie.
Death is proving to be a valuable teammate.
First day, they weren't really stable, and when Death came in, he was stable all throughout the game, from the laning stage until we finished the game. So I think that was the X factor that Death brought to the team.
Welcome back to the last match for Neon in the group stages, and potentially their last match of the ONE Esports Singapore Major, depending on this result and depending on Alliance's games as well. But they're actually cutting around, man. That Wrath of Nature does so much damage. Now I'm going to choke, but they're going to be careful. Liquid, how deep are they going?
They're
magnetized. It's too much AoE damage, just ticking them down constantly. A three-man sign to it. Play Hard is tearing them apart on this Earth Spirit. A full team wipe as Neon are bringing the battle to Liquid in this series.
It is a team effort that is taking down the European Giants.
He's dragging them straight on top of Insania. DeBill's just going to TP in the middle five with the protection of the BKB. Quifton's training drop.
Oh my god, so much damage.
But Brady just shred him apart. Insania still gets the ultimate off. DeBill can't stand his ground now. He's lost all of his damage, but at least with the false promise, or can he? DeBill's pushing back Quifton. That's a dieback from Insania. And they've got no buybacks all off. It's just Mickey holding his life, and wow.
If there's anything that we've learned, it's that C Dota is the best Dota in the entire world.
We went against Team Liquid, who was very strong in the first day of the group stage. So we were very determined to get our scores up. And luckily enough, we got the 2-0.
Neon now coming through, playing with Death, and he's looking like that is the answer they were needing. But you know, maybe they got something going for them at the moment, because they turned it around pretty drastically here. 2-0-ing Team Liquid, And now, like you said, this puts him in a very good opportunity to move on.
Turns out all you need is just a nice, soothing Singaporean voice in death, as opposed to just people yelling, ha ha, bobo, at your face the entire time. So good job to Neon. It puts a lot of pressure on Alliance.
OB Neon's win against Liquid finally puts them ahead of Alliance and safe from elimination. However, it's not over yet. The last series between Alliance and Team Liquid will finalize the overall standings. OB Neon isn't in the clear yet.
So they bait with the illusion. Tiger gets away anyway, and now the arena's down, and well, they've started the Roshan. I'm not sure about this. Dreamcoil out, Foxy, he's gonna lock them down immediately onto the DP. There goes Yexism. It's all over, it looks like. There's the Echo coming out, Harmskin. It's not really that much damage. Coil committed immediately. He'll get the Fisher out, but Mikkei, he's having his way with Alliance. The game's over, they call the GG. And with that, Liquid will at least get the first game victory. I do mean that believes, John, that Alliance, unfortunately, will be forced into last place.
I'm very sad, but there's no chance for them to make it through to the playoffs.
When we finished the 2-0 against Liquid, yeah, we weren't sure if we were going to move forward to the lower bracket. So we were waiting for the last series of Team Liquid and Alliance. And when the Liquid taking the game, we were really happy. We were excited. I'm very proud. Even though coming into Singapore, we had a stand-in, and then again, we had another stand-in. They accomplished a lot. So right now, we just need to focus on the next match.
In the next episode of Heroes of the Game,
arena on the floor with
the Singapore Major playoffs begin.
Everybody's like really fired up, like we really wanted to win this. I think we'll be able to beat anybody.
Longtime rivals take the grand stage.
The relationship between Fnatic and Neon is stream a lot against them, so we pretty much know each other.
It's a bit sad because we have to face a fellow SEA team.
Ex-teammates face off in the high-stakes tournament.
We were up against Evil Geniuses today. Two of our former players are with them.
And rookie Dota team OB Neon make their debut at the playoffs.
A lot of Filipinos are actually really happy for them. It's good to see to have a new C representative doing good in the international scene.
If there's a dark horse in the Singapore Major, it will be us.